Hey, hey! Welcome to this new episode of What Is on Climabyte. Today, we will talk about a very important tool in geoscience, remote sensing. In a sentence, what is remote sensing? It is, quite literally, a method to sense things, which is measuring them, remotely, which is from a distance. This simple definition could describe a wide range of tools. For instance, if I'm taking a picture of something, I am remotely sensing it. But remote sensing actually refers to the use of airborne, or nowadays mostly spaceborne, measurement systems in order to map and to understand better the planet they are flying over. Usually, the Earth, but scientists won't be stopped by mere interplanetary space. Remote sensing is a complex and varied science, and hundreds of different satellites are currently orbiting the Earth. These allow scientists to gather a lot of different data in a lot of ways, on a lot of things, over a lot of places. From the concentration of certain gases on the atmosphere, to the type of trees in a given forest, to the height of waves in the ocean, or to the soil moisture in agricultural fields. The examples are endless. Remote sensing allows for the monitoring of the whole planet without needing expensive fieldwork to more or less accessible areas, as well as the detection of phenomena that just can't be seen from the ground. We can trace the history of satellite remote sensing to the Corona project, an American spy program aimed at obtaining images of enemy territory during the Cold War. And the satellites used film that had to be ejected from space and then recovered with planes dragging huge butterfly nets. In remote sensing, there is sensing. To be able to sense, you need sensors. These sensors, embarked on satellites, are split in two categories, passive and active sensors. Passive sensors are just receivers. They capture the signal that reached them. A camera is a good example of a passive sensor, simply recording the light reaching it. Active sensors send signals and record what comes back. An example is a laser altimeter. It sends a laser beam, that's the active part, which hits the ground and comes back. The altimeter then records the time the process took and computes the distance using the speed of light. Other examples of active sensors are radar systems that can see through clouds, among other advantages. One of the most popular family of sensors is the optical family. They are basically space cameras taking images of the Earth from space. The WorldView 3 satellite can, for instance, take pictures where a pixel represents a 30 by 30 centimeters area of the ground from over 600 kilometers away. This is very useful to map the world in high definition. If these images are really nice indeed, they're only in what we call the visible spectrum, or in the colors that humans can see. Let's have a look at this image of Koblenz in Germany, taken by the RapidEye satellite. We can divide the visible spectrum in three channels, or bands, blue, green, and red. But some optical sensors, like this one, don't suffer from our human eyes' limitations and can see much more colors. We can, for instance, look at the infrared band. Why would we want to do that? Well, we see different things in that band. For instance, we can see in the color image that we have two football stadiums here. We can see that the grass is green in both. But if we look in the infrared image, one of the stadiums is bright and the other is very dark. That's because the second one is actually covered in synthetic grass that is green colored to the eye, but is not infrared colored. If you ask an expert in remote sensing what color are trees or grass, it will tell you that they are very infrared and really not red. Oh, and somehow green. They actually use something called the Normalized Difference Vegetation Index, or NDVI, a virtual band made up using a combination of the red and infrared bands in which the plant's greenness, or in more scientific terms, its photosynthetic activity, is easy to measure. Sensors systems like ASTER or Landsat 8 can see in even more colors, detecting even more characteristics of the Earth's surface and atmosphere, like temperature or the concentration of pollutants. So, when do we use this? Remote sensing is used for an endless list of scientific and commercial endeavors. It is used in cooperation with rescue units in case of large-scale catastrophes, like big forest fires or floods. It can be used by the military to spy on enemy activities, or simply by Google to create Google Earth. When images of the same area are taken at different times, forming what we call time series, things like environmental monitoring become possible. Recording variation in moisture levels of the soil during droughts, the evolution of tropical forests, or the volume change of glaciers is only a few clicks away. So remote sensing, such a rich and various tool used by a lot of different people with a lot of different goals, and a very important tool for us geoscientists. I hope you learned something climate-bitey today. If so, don't forget to like and share this video, and to subscribe if you want to become even more climate-bitey. I'll see you next time!